this video, I'm going to show how I installed solar panels and lithium iron batteries on my 2020 Thor Omni SV34. Let's talk about some of the components I chose for my solar upgrade for the Thor SV34 motor coach. For batteries, I decided to go with the lithium batteries, lithium iron phosphate to be specific, to replace the lead acids that are already in the coach. One reason is it takes less maintenance for these batteries. You can be a little less diligent about upkeeping them. And they give a little more power. You don't have to, with lead acid, you need to stay at about half, 50% discharge. If you go below that, you start damaging the batteries. With lithiums, you don't have to worry about that so much. And you can leave them discharged, and it's not going to affect their life as much. The batteries I went with are from GoPower. They're Sun Cycle lithium batteries, 12 volts, 250 amp hours. And I have two of them, so that will give me 500 amp hours. And you can look at these, they're actually quite big. They're probably twice the size of your typical lead acid battery. We put a tape measure up here, about 9 inches wide. 19 or so in length. Height-wise, also about 9 inches. And that's one consideration with these. You'll see in the other part of this video that the battery tray for the SV34 under the stairs, the small lead acids fit in there, but these won't. You put two of these in there, there's not physically possible to get them into the tray. So you need to plan that a little bit, and I'll show you where I decided to put them in the coach. Moving on, we have the Renogy DC to DC charger. And this is quite a little gizmo. What it allows you to do is your alternator in the coach won't charge a lithium correctly. It might overcharge it, might undercharge it. It's not meant for the lithiums. It's meant for a typical motor vehicle battery, lead acid. And it can take a lot of voltage and not really worry about it. You need to be a little more careful with the lithiums, and plus you want to get into a full charge. So this little gizmo, 50 amps you see, it replaces two components. It replaces the solar charge controller, and it gives you a DC to DC charger, which you could do two components. You could do a solar charger, and you can do a DC to DC charger. This just combines both products and makes it a little simpler. And we'll go into more of that later in the video. The Overlander Solar Charging Kit comes with a 30 amp PWM solar charge controller. This can be used to replace the 10 amp controller that came with the Omni motor coach. And it will allow you to have more than one solar panel. If you're going to use lithium iron batteries, though, you will need to get a new DC to DC charger that allows your coach alternator to charge the lithium batteries with the right correct charge profile. The other component I have here, sorry for the lighting. You can see it's a Wilco lithium iron deck mount converter charger. So there is one of these in the coach. Comes with the Thor. The problem is, again, it's not meant for lithium batteries. It has a different charge profile. And this isn't very expensive, $200 or so. And you just got to swap it out. Of course, I have a couple cables here and connectors and wires, and just started collecting some of the pieces I needed. The batteries. And these batteries come with these nice lugs that go on the terminals here. The other component of a solar system is obviously the solar panels. So what I went with, again, is GoPower. GoPower has the SAR charge controller in the coach, as I'll show you in the coach walkthrough. And the charger in there, the solar charge controller in there, is a 10 amp controller. So these panels, each panel, you can see is 190 watts. It's your regular size panel, but pretty good output. Looking at the specs, you can see 190 watts, 9.3 amps. And the Overlander kit comes with a 30 amp charger. So if you're going to add, you know, looking at the 9.3 amps, for the 10 amp charger already in the coach, you can only have one panel, 190 watts, and you're maxed out. So with this kit, let's see the kit, It comes with the 30 amp charger to replace the 10 amp in the coach. Comes with wires, comes with connectors and the panel. To expand the system, instead of having the solar charger kit, you get the Overlander solar expansion kit. And basically what this is the exact same panel, some connectors and wires, but no solar charge controller. So you're just getting more panels. Again, same spec, 190 watt, 9.3 amps. So here's the back side of the panel. It comes with pigtails. Comes pre-drilled holes for your brackets. It comes with angled brackets, appear to be stainless. Slotted hole, two round holes. The two round holes go into your roof for your RV. The slotted hole goes on the edge of the panel. And you'll use a bolt, two washers, and a lock nut to get that fastened. When you're done, it'll look like this. Here's the back of the panel where the wire splices come out. You'll see it has a serial number. And then the specs for the panel. One thing to note is they use MC4 connectors. It's pretty standard in the industry. What you have is you have a female. I know it looks like a male, but it's a female. And then you have the male. Two different connectors. And one thing that's critical is you need to know the polarity of your panel, which is positive, which is negative. I've determined on these panels that the female is the positive and the male is the negative. You can do other research on the YouTube and show you how to determine positive and negative. You can pull this cover and there's some clues in there. And you just got to make sure, especially if you're using panels from different manufacturers, which I don't know if that's a wise idea, you got to make sure you keep your polarity correct, positive to positive, negative to negative. If you're doing parallel, if you're doing series, you need to have a grasp of that and keep that information straight. Taking a closer look at the charger, converter charger, however you want to call it, this is the model I chose. It's very similar to the one that is already in the coach. Again, this one's just made for lithium ion batteries and not for the lead acid. If you're starting from scratch and you don't have a Thor, you'd have a different model, you might go a different route. But this one, the reason I chose it is it's literally going to be a plug and play. It's going to be a direct replacement for what's already in the coach. Wire off, wire on, you're good to go. Same size, same footprint, can go in the same place. No hassles, no worries. What the converter charger does is when you're plugged into shore power or if you're running your generator, you get 120 volts, 110 volts coming into your coach. Your transfer switch will automatically kick over to use that as your power source. It'll kick off your 12 volt. And this converter will convert the 110 volt AC current to the 12 volt DC current, 12 volt nominal. So this will charge your battery when you're plugged into shore power or when your generator's running. Whenever you have that 110 running, this will be charging your batteries. Before you do your installation, you're going to want to do a little research. Some of the research you need to do has to deal with the structure of your coach. I was able to obtain these diagrams from my manufacturer, Thor. Thor provided them to me. You have kind of a 3D schematic of the makeup of your roof or your coach. You can see my two ACs there. You can see where the vents are, sky dome there. And then you have this sheet too. This sheet is a simplified 2D, you know, flat version of the roof framing of my coach. And this is critical. If you notice item number 3 there, the ribs are a little different than the other ones, a little wider. If you look up at the top, it has a kind of a key of what the framing is. Number 3 are roof truss supports. And you'll see that those are, what the difference between those are, is those come up to the top of the roof sheathing on your coach. In my case, I have a thin plywood sheathing, I have the ribs, and there's insulation. But only the 3s come up to the top of that, below the plywood, the top of the insulation. The other ones are held or flat. The roof coach has a crown to it, so that way water doesn't puddle up there. And also key number 8. 8 are tubes along the edges of the coach. That's where I found structure. You're going to want to anchor to structure, not to the plywood, not to the roofing. I know some people do, but it's imperative that you get to structure so your panels don't fly away as you're going down the highway. It's a pretty important detail. Some of the other research you're going to need to do is obviously electrical. We're working with the electrical system. So also Thor was able to provide me was the electrical schematics. This page here happens to be the 110 fuse panel layout. Has the generator, short cord, it kind of shows how everything connected, what the circuits are. Some of the fusing. So the Thor one up here, Thor in magnitude. You do some of the auxiliary fuses you'll find on the coach. You get some layouts here, some of the equipment. Again, some more equipment layouts. And then you get to this. This is the wiring loom in your coach in schematic format. So this is going to tell you how things connect. And it's kind of important to figure out some of the stuff. Let's focus down here to the right. Isolator relay. So this is down in the battery cage under the coach. And this connects to your chassis batteries, connects to your house batteries, connects to quite a few things. And so we're going to bypass this isolator because our Renogy DCC50S is also an isolator. So we don't need two of them. So we need to study this and find out where these panels go. The main lugs are obviously the batteries. Smaller lugs on this unit go to different, so this goes to the battery, the ignition, ground, switch. So there's quite a few things that we got to consider. Here is the manufacturer's schematic for that battery isolation manager, BIM. There's kind of a prettier picture of the unit, the big lugs, small lugs. It's just upside down from what's in the schematic from Thor. But in this document, down here, it's going to show you what connects to what, and that's really important. So, you have the chassis battery and the coach battery, and this isolates the two, but lets the alternator charge both of them, but, you're not going to drain down the coach battery. So, again, we're bypassing this. We're going to use the DCC50S. And so we just need to know what goes where, what these wires are going. It's going to help you determine which wires you need to hook up to your DCC50S and some of the specs on this unit. Let's go back to the 110 diagram we had of the fuse panel. Remember this? So I think I pointed out that we have the generator shown here. We have the auto transfer switch. So when you plug in to shore or your generator's running, this transfer switch is going to provide you your 110 power. Alternatively, when you don't have the generator 110 power running, you're going to be running some of your 110 circuits off of your batteries. Not all of them, because you drain your batteries too quick, but some of them. So what we have up here is we have your inverter. So remember how the converter takes 110 volt and changes it to 12 volts? This does just the opposite. It takes 12 volts from your battery and converts it to 110. So you can see the one line diagram goes up here. And your TV and your refrigerator running. So those are the ones you want your refrigerator to stay cold, so that's important. And there's one other circuit I know in the SV34 that's over the dinette that is also live with the batteries off the inverter. Skipping over to the right here. So remember that converter that I'm gonna switch out from the lead acid one to the lithium one? Well, there's the converter in this diagram. So again, fuse panel to converter, and we're gonna be swapping that out. So going in converter, again, this is the 110 volt schematic layout for your electrical. Let's go back to the 12 volt wiring now, your wiring loom. This is that same thing we saw before. It's just, there's three different versions of this drawing. This one's overlaid on the coach with the slide out. So back, rear of the coach, kind of see the outline of the bed there. That's where that converter is located. So if you go down to schematic, there it is right there. Converter, red, white. 6-gauge wire. So again, we're just going to do a plug and play swap out of that. Take out the converter that's there, put the new converter in, we'll be good to go for lithium. So what I tried to do here was to sketch out my system in schematic detail. Let's go a few of the things. These are my existing house batteries. The two 6-volt batteries wired in parallel. So you get 12 volts. It's about 105 amp hours is all we're getting out of those. And then you can only use half of that, so maybe 50 amp hours. It's pretty weak, way too small for this coach. Here's the battery isolator that we talked about before. This one's in the coach. But we're going to be bypassing that. We're not going to be using that anymore because remember our DCC50S, that solar charge controller, DC to DC charger, is also an isolator. So we won't need the existing one. And here's our existing chassis battery, you know, up under the hood of the truck. So getting rid of these batteries, we're going to have two new batteries. These are the two new lithium iron phosphate batteries I talked about. So again, we're going to put those in series. So that way we have two 12 volt batteries. We're going to stay 12 volts, but we're going to double our amp hours. So remember we had 250 amp hours. Now we have 500 amp hours and we can use most of that. You shouldn't take it down to zero, but you don't have to stay at half. And then what we have shown up in the upper left here is my three solar panels, also wired in series. So that way the 12 volt panels stay 12 volts. We connect the three together. 3 times 190 watts equals 570 watts. And the 9.3 amps times 3 will be 27.9 amps. So almost 28 amps will be able to come into the charger to charge our new batteries. So here is my Omni SV34 from the exterior. SV34 has one large slide on the driver's side. And let's start with what the electrical system has now for solar. The main door is to the front of the cab. Inside your step well here. Upper step. And that's where the two 6-volt batteries are wired in series to get you 12 volts. It's not a battery tray down there. And the only way to get the batteries in is through this opening, through the opening in the step. I've tried from down below, I've even done measurements. And with the batteries you see in this video that I'm adding, there's no way they're gonna fit inside there. No way to get them in, no way to fit. And so we have another solution. You'll see later on in this video that I show you a wiring diagram. And the wire diagram talks about several fuses. There they are. And also the battery isolation manager. And that is down there. That is what that element is. Sorry, I can't get my phone down in there. But that's your battery isolation manager attached to the side of the battery tray. So in the SV34 layout, you come up the steps, you have a dinette right behind the door. This is part of the slide, the couch, the kitchen. In the dinette area, under this tray, let me take the cushions off for you. Under the cushions, you have this storage area. It has a drawer towards the front that pulls out, but only goes partway in. On the back part of this, there's a bracket for seat belts, and then this is the back of your controls. A little better lighting there for you. Some cabling in the back of your controls. This is your control panel. On the opposite side is where all your electronics are. So that's super handy in that our solar controller that comes with the unit, the wiring is right there. So my plan is to put the batteries right in this area. They're monsters, they'll fit there. I'm just going to take this seat bracket out. I don't plan on traveling with a lot of people that need all these seat belts. There's seat belts on the other side of the dinette. So I can lose these, and there's also seat belts at the couch. So I can lose these and not affect my use of the vehicle. So I've taken the lead acid batteries, the 6 volts, out of the motorhome. And there's the battery isolation manager. If you'll remember in an earlier video in the dinette, we had the drawer and we had the space underneath the one bench. The drawer only went part way in, and the rest of the bin was open. So this is where I installed the batteries, the two lithium iron batteries from GoPower. It's a snug fit, so snug such that I had to cut the handles off of the one side of the battery so they would fit in there. Plenty of room on this side. You see the handles. I cut the handles off the other side. They're just pieces of plastic. I just snipped them off. You can see the batteries are wired in series. So you have the positive to positive to the breaker. You have negative to negative. And there's a common negative pole right here. That's a common negative. And then to that breaker. And on the end of the bay, I mounted a board. And on the board, I was able to mount the solar charge controller and DC to DC charger. And next to that are the two breakers. So the one line is from the batteries. The other breaker is the positive from the coach. And there's the back side of where the other electronics were. Here you'll see the side clips of the batteries that I had to trim back. You'll see I just cut it back kind of flush to the side of the battery so it would fit between the below the seat there in the SV34. Here's a little flyover of the finished install on the motorhome. You got one forward panel and two rear next to the AC units. The forward one's next to the skylight. And here's a bird's eye view of the install. Again, one forward panel, two in the rear. Here's a close-up view of the three panels. I guess I need to clean them a little bit too here. You'll see the wiring between the units. I had to buy two splice wires to connect the three panels based on the layout. On that left panel there, you'll see where it comes through the roof. Here's the forward panel, the forward edge of it with the two clips. Important, when you screw down these clips, you'll pre-drill, but you'll want to put some die-core or something compatible with your roofing material below the clip, so that will seal up the hole so you won't get any leaks in your roof. Here's a picture of the sealant I used. Again, check with your type of roofing and what's compatible. The two rear panels, I was only able to get structure on the sides of them. So I did this two bars here. I crossed them up and I screwed them into that one of the other cross ribs behind the front panel. Again, a little more anchorage for my panels. Here's the rear panels. You can see the side connections along the edge of the roof. Two clips there. You can see the crossing bars up there behind that front panel. One more view of the side there next to the awning. So to the right side of the rear AC unit, that's where the solar wires come through the roof pre-installed in the factory. And it's compatible with the MC4 connector. So again, I bought those two splice wires, able to cook the panels together and connect right into the connection that's already on the roof. And here's the rear. This is the one connection where I wasn't able to get to structure. So that foot is just screwed down into the sheathing. But again, that's why I added those cross braces up front. And why did I do this? Well, with my travels this summer, I was able to visit Yellowstone, Grand Tetons, Grand Canyon. And I don't need to worry about there being power at any of the sites. I was able to pull up, do my thing, didn't need to plug in anything. The only thing you would really need power for would be if you want to run your ACs. The weather was nice up where I was, so didn't need to use power. So the fridge, all my electronics, everything worked. The batteries never drained. The 390-watt solar panels and the two 250-amp-hour lithium batteries was plenty of power for everything I needed to do. Thank you for watching, and let me know if you have any questions. Post them down below, and I will try to answer as best I can.